You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us with his tail between his legs in Los Angeles, crawling back to me to apologize, comedian, comedy writer, Liam McEneaney. Hello there, Liam.
Hi, David. How are you? It's so great to be on your podcast.
Hey, congratulations.
It's such an honor.
Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. For what?
For getting on the David Feldman Show.
You know what? I had a really hard time booking this podcast. I had to pick up my phone and say yes to you.
You've been invited back.
I have. I am a returning champion for the David Feldman Show. And let me tell you something. Of the 13 things I should be doing right now, this is easily my top 1 through 12 favorite.
So are you going to apologize for leaving New York City and going to Los Angeles and discovering that David Feldman was right, telling you not to move, to stay in New York, to fight it out?
Well, first of all, let me apologize to the good people of New York City for moving. I didn't realize what a blow it would be to civic pride. And, you know, I found it really touching because actually the city of New York, to kind of as a gesture to reach out to me, I understand they threw an entire civic pride parade this past weekend to, like, show how proud they are of their city and how much they miss me.
And I marched in that. You told me, you said to me, hey, David, there's a big pride to honor Liam McEneaney. It would be really great for you to put on your short shorts and a tank top and march.
Right.
And I did.
I wanted you to get a healthy tan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and, you know, I guess, like, this to symbolize that even though I'm gone, there's still a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow.
Mm-hmm.
I understand the city, like, supplied a lot of people with rainbow flags and outfits and assless chaps. And I was really very touched at how much the entire city of New York missed me.
Yeah. You know what I noticed? How flamboyant your fans are.
Oh, when they get excited, they just can't help but dance and burst in the song.
This is Liam McEneaney. Best week ever. What's the name of your big show? Tell Your Friends About It. Or what's it called?
The best week ever is definitely my best credit. I have done nothing in the last 11 years. So, luckily, best week ever. If there's one thing you know about Viacom shows, VH1 gave me enough money to retire on after that. So, if you're listening at home, it's not a sign of laziness that David could only supply a credit from 11 years ago. A sign that he didn't research, maybe. It's just really kind of where I peaked in my career.
That's not true. What's the name of your new comedy CD?
It's called Working Class Fancy from Comedy Dynamics.
Right.
You can hear it on Sirius XM. It's in pretty heavy rotation right now. I'm very proud of it. A lot of people seem to like it. I really feel like I'm making it in L.A. because I can see a Scientology building from where I'm sitting.
Are you sitting out at the cafe near UCB?
No, actually, I mean, I'm in Malibu right now. In my rental, things aren't going as well as I'd hoped out here. So I could only rent a home out in Malibu for the season.
Aww.
So hopefully, you know, things will turn around and I can buy something. But right now I'm in Malibu and, you know, it's not as big as I'd hoped. And I kind of have to share a beach with Madonna and Bob Dylan.
Are you doing like an Airbnb where you live in the maid's quarters? And
no, this is, you know, Steve and Kate. Stephen Kate, Spielberg and Capshaw. Well, they got divorced a while ago, and this house was joint property, and neither of them wanted to sell because it would mean that the other one made a lot of money. So they just kind of leave it empty most of the year. And Steve, you know Steve, right? Spielberg, he offered to let me rent it from him for a reasonable price.
The whole house?
Whole house. I mean, it's not that big. You know, it's like a few bedrooms. I have a couple of friends who are going to come and stay with me over the summer, and you know.
Oh, so you sublet? So you charge them to stay with you?
No. They're going to. You know, it's kind of like one of those deals where it's like I let you know Lauren and Michaels, you might know him, and Marty Short and Steve Martin. I don't know if you know those guys, but I let them stay with me, and then we'll all go out to St. Bart's for a couple of weeks, and I'll stay with them, and like, you know, that kind of, it's just that kind of deal, you know? It's like a friends helping each other kind of deal.
So you're kind of like a personal assistant. The comedy didn't go well, and you're kind of renting this house as a business, and you invite these people like Lauren Michaels, Steve Martin, Marty Short to stay at the house, and then you kind of make them dinner.
No.
Answer their call, right?
No, it's more like I met Lauren Michaels through Steven Spielberg. I think I told you I know him. I was writing I was helping him. I mean, I wasn't even writing it. I wish I was lead writer. I was one of the people who was helping George write the new Indiana Jones movie.
George?
Lucas. It doesn't really, he's half retired, so you might not have run into him.
Oh, so hey, that's great. You're a writer's assistant for these guys. You're going to learn a lot just typing what they say into a computer, and I bet they'll take some of your ideas and trust you. You'll get to see some of your words on the screen.
You pretty much described what it's like to so-called collaborate with George and Steven. George just, you know, throws out ideas, and I'm writing, and at the end of the day, Steven's just like, look, I've read your other work. I trust your gut. You can just throw that stuff away.
This is such a great lesson in business management. Guys like George Lucas and Steven Spielberg.
They're filmmakers. I don't know if you've heard of them.
Yes, I have.
And the way they direct. Okay.
And no idea should be rejected. And it doesn't matter who the idea comes from. If it's good, it should stand on its own. And somebody like you, who's been hired on as a writer's assistant, is called a collaborator. And I think that's such a great way to run your business, where everybody is kind of equal.
I'm more of a co-writer. But listen, enough about me.
No, that's great.
I heard you got nominated for an award for that puppet show you were writing for. What was that puppet show called?
I want to get back to you moving to Hollywood and making a mistake, realizing that it wasn't going to work out. And then when it didn't work out and you realized you weren't going to make it, that David Feldman was correct, you made lemonade. You did a gut check. You looked in the mirror and said, okay, I'm not an actor. I'm not a writer.
Right.
I have things to learn. I'll go get it.
I mean, I will be acting in the new Indiana Jones movie, but generally I'm not an actor.
See, that's why.
I'm only going to be like third or fourth build. So, yeah, I mean, it's like not really that big of a deal.
It's like you're going to school. That's what Steve and Spielberg and George Lucas do. They take somebody like you a production assistant, a writer's assistant like you.
Writer, yes.
And they say, you know what? We want you to learn everything. We're going to give you a job as an extra in this movie as well. So you're like in the background scene, right?
Well, I'm in the background of a lot of scenes, but I'm mostly a co-lead, I think is the term.
This is so great. It's so egalitarian that they would call an extra a co-lead. That's fantastic.
Right.
These are the Hollywood values that we have to bring to the rest of the country. These progressive...
You know Harrison, right? Whenever he's on screen, nobody's looking at me. I get what you're saying. My job is mostly to react to whatever he's doing. So you're right. You know, like, I'm definitely like, not the lead, but I would say, co-star maybe, or other star, or star after the star maybe.
You know, I've always wanted to start a comedy think tank with this podcast, and that's exactly how I would run it. Everybody's a co-star. Everybody.
Right.
Is a writer.
Because I think a lot of people feel like your podcast is a lot like community theater, you know, like comedy community theater, like a charity gig almost, you know, like everyone comes in and pitches in equally.
My concern for you, and I'm glad things are going well, and I think it's really great that
I don't want you to feel like things aren't going. I mean, okay, so you know how they're already prepping the new Transformers movie?
Uh-huh.
Right. So you know, I was kind of, you know, asked to write the first few drafts of that. And then, you know, but the thing is, because the last Transformers movie didn't do so well, like, usually you get a $500,750 for this kind of work. But now they're saying, like, oh, well, we'll pay you $250,000 and then we'll give you a bump every $50 million that the picture grosses at the box office internationally. So it's like, yes, that could I could technically walk away with $1 million, but will I be making as much money as I should right off the bat? Not really. So, I mean, just I don't want you to feel like things are going that well for me.
So that's what the guy writing the Transformer movie said to you to justify why he's paying you so little to be his assistant.
Well, producing the Transformer movie, who hired me to write, when I had a conversation with Michael Bay about it, yes.
You met Michael Bay?
Well, some would say Michael Bay met me, but yes, I would say we met each other for dinner.
You met him through the writer you're working for? The writer?
He heard some of my comedy on the radio, and then he asked for some writing samples, and then he asked to meet me.
Did you feel insulted that he asked for writing samples? That's got to be. I hope you put the writing samples together and you swallowed your pride, because you never know, Liam, when one of these jobs can turn into something more than just being an assistant.
Right. I absolutely agree. I mean, like, part of my deal, because I'm getting paid so little, is the studio has to finance the script that I sent them as a sample. You know, they really liked it, and at first they were like, no, but then the whole pay thing came up. So I'm going to write and direct it and star in it, like kind of do the Woody Allen thing. Well, not going to be a big budget deal.
Hold on to that dream, my friend, because you're meeting the right people, and eventually this can come to fruition.
Well, I mean, we'll see. You know, it's just like, it kind of stinks, because if this film thing goes through, then I'm going to have to put my sitcom on the back burner. And that was just kind of what I came to L.A. to do, you know?
Are you spreading yourself too thin, being a writer's assistant to Michael Bay's new writer, and then being a writer's assistant to George Lucas and Steven Spielberg? I mean, being a writer's assistant takes up a lot of time. Uh-huh. I'm worried that you're burning the candle both ends.
I was also worried about that. And then I read this book. It's kind of my how-to manual on surviving in Hollywood. It's called The Kid Stays in the Picture.
Robert Evans.
Oh, you've heard of it. You know, Robert, I met him, you know, whatever. He seemed nice enough guy. But in the book, they talk about this creative aid that they use called cocaine. And, you know, I hadn't heard of this cocaine before, but apparently it adds about 7 to 8 hours to your working day.
How can you afford cocaine on a writer's assistant salary? I mean, what do they pay?
If I could get one of my assistants fired and take their salary, then I wouldn't have to go out of pocket for this cocaine.
Wait a second.
That's a really good idea.
This is so wasteful in Hollywood. And that's generous, I have to admit. Writer's assistants have their own assistants.
I don't know if my assistants have their own assistants. If they do, then I could definitely see how I could maybe get some more money for this cocaine, because I have to tell you something. I'm really enjoying the cocaine even more than the writing and the directing and the producing.
But cocaine is very expensive. I just don't see where you have the money to buy something like that.
You know what? You caught me. And I guess I wasn't going to talk about this, because I'm only kind of talking about the glamour gigs. But I will be headlining a few arenas across the country over the next year. Like, you know, Madison Square Garden and O2 in London, and, you know, just like a few, like, select bigger arenas. I'm going to have Louis C.K. opening for me kind of deal. So that's pretty much where my coke money is going to come from.
I don't understand.
I like coke a lot. And it's, as you said, it's very expensive.
The other stuff. The arena?
I haven't touched the other stuff. I'd be afraid to try anything, you know, harder than cocaine.
No. I'm talking about...
I understand cocaine can be a gateway drug, mushrooms and acid.
No. I'm talking about you headlining Madison Square Garden.
Right, Madison Square... It's not a real garden. It's like a big arena where normally sports teams play.
Yeah, I got that.
I'm not doing like a garden, not in back of someone's house. It's like a real arena. I don't, used to be in a place called Madison Square.
I get all that. I know about Madison Square Garden. What I don't get is you're headlining Madison Square Garden. That I'm looking this up on the internet as we speak, and I do see Liam McEneaney, Three Nights at Madison Square Garden, August 5th,
correct,
6th and 7th. Louis C.K. and Todd Barry are the opening acts.
Todd got on the show. Okay, that's good.
Whew. What's that about? I feel like you've kind of misled me here.
Well, no, I just didn't know Todd was also on the show. I would have told you.
No, I just feel like you entered into this interview on false pretenses.
Well, I mean, you know, it's like I've only been in L.A. for 9 months. I haven't had that much time to accomplish anything.
Well,
let's talk about you. How'd your show at QED go last night?
So wait a second. So you're headlining Madison Square Garden.
Well, I would say, you know, I'm closing it out.
It says here, star of the new HBO series, Liam.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know we were announcing that. Yeah. You know, it's like I didn't really want to do it, but then I did Judd's show at large. You know Judd Apatow? You met Judd? David? Hello?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Have you met Judd?
Yeah.
Yeah, you met Judd Apatow?
Yeah.
All right, so I did Judd's show at Largo. And are you not crying, are you? It sounds like you're crying a little bit.
No, if it does, it would be because I'd be happy for you.
Oh, fantastic. Then, yeah. You know, 'cause I wasn't going to bring it up because, you know, like, I feel like some of my less accomplished friends, you know, get a little bummed out when I talk about how great.
Do you think that I would be jealous of you for all this? That I wouldn't be happy?
No. No, of course. I mean, you've got your memories of The Daily Show, and that's great, too.
No, I mean, you didn't. I'm just concerned that you started this interview and you kept certain information from me about your career. And I'm worried that you thought that I would resent your success because you think I don't have enough success in my own career. So you were just kind of trying to fit in by not telling me about Liam on HBO.
Well, here's the thing. I had a long conversation with Alex Brazell. You know him? He runs Showbiz Studios.
I haven't spoken to him. Have you spoken? He doesn't. I haven't spoken to him in a couple of weeks.
Oh, yeah. He's always calling me, just pitching his clients for different shows and jobs and stuff like that.
I introduced you to Alex.
Right.
I think it's great that Alex and you have a relationship because that's what this business is all about. It's giving wings to youth and letting them fly. That's what it's all about. So you spoke to Alex, huh?
I spoke to Alex Brazell. He's telling me, like, I should hire Matt Golditch because he's a great writer. And he's like, you know, who else is a great writer is Kevin Bartini, mm-hmm. who has a podcast on my network. And
good, good. It's always, that's good, good. Because when they succeed, we all succeed. Yeah, good. Great.
Yeah, and he was like, you should hire my friend I went to college with who's never written for anything before, but, you know, he would probably be good in a writer's room. And I was like, sure, I'll take a chance on that kid. Why not, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the guy at the deli across the street had a couple funny jokes and maybe he could write for your roast set next month.
You're doing a roast?
Well, Comedy Central's doing their roast. So Mike Myers, you know, Mike Myers from Austin Powers and mm-hmm. Love Guru.
I didn't know that they were doing a roast.
Yeah, Mike asked me to do it as a favor. I can't say no
to
Mike.
Alex, who's my producer and my manager, he probably...
Oh, he's your manager? Oh, that's interesting. Oh. Huh. That's interesting, because your name didn't really... So, all right. Well, okay, great. Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, I didn't know. He knows that I'm being very selective about my writing work.
Oh, yeah. That's right. He said something about that.
Yeah.
He said you really wanted to focus on your puppet show and your podcast.
Yeah. Yeah.
By the way, congratulations. Cable Ace Award?
Yeah.
I don't know. One of those things.
So how long did you know about Liam being on HBO? How long did Alex know about this? I'm just kind of curious.
Oh, it's just one of those things where, you know, I was at a party.
Did Alex make the deal?
Well, he's the one who introduced me to Lena, you know, Dunham.
Yeah.
She had a show on HBO for a little bit. I guess he and her are good friends, and he's gotten a couple of people staffed on that show over the last couple of years before it went off the air. So we went to the finale party, and I start talking to some people, and, you know, they were just like, oh, you know what? We've never seen your stand-up or read a word you've written, but you're such an interesting person, you should just have a TV show. Anyways,
I mean, I told you not to move to Los Angeles because it's quicksand.
Dude, you're stuck there.
You're stuck there now. You're stuck.
I mean, like, I could have been in New York City doing shows at QED.
Now you're trapped.
You know, living in a rent-stabilized apartment in Central Queens like I was.
Now you're trapped in this endless cycle of movies and sitcoms and on the road. I told you not.
And it's like, you can't really have a relationship, like a strict relationship with a woman. You know, like, it's like that kind of fulfilling relationship that you want. So I'm just like dating these two women and, you know, which is kind of,
yeah.
You know,
so did Alex,
it's expensive to date two women.
Did Alex say anything about my possibly doing a guest set at Madison Square Garden in between Todd Barry and Louis C.K.? Cause I'm.
Oh, I love you, David. You're like the best. Like, I'm like this guy who became famous, and then you're like the rag picker that I fondly remember, you know, like giving scraps of food to. Like, I feel like that's the kind of relationship we have, right?
I love it.
I
love it when you make fun of me because I know you don't mean it.
I'll tell you what, David, I am offering 5 minutes at my secret QED show. I'm doing a secret show at QED midnight on around the time that I'm doing Madison Square Garden. That's all I can say legally. And I'm offering stage time to anyone who can hook me up with cocaine in New York City. You know, as fun as the Madison Square Garden gig is, this is the cocaine that I'm really like, it's really kind of become my overriding interest.
The show for HBO, Liam?
Yes, with an exclamation point.
Where are they making it?
Well, we're going to film it in New York City.
At Buttercup over in Queens?
Yes, Buttercup Studios.
Oh, man.
And also, we're just going to be filming all over the city.
What
you
a
know,
night.
Like,
see, that, again, I'm living in Manhattan, and the idea of having to get up and go take a writing job and schlep all the way out to Buttercup Studios in Queens.
I wouldn't do that to you. I would never do that to you.
Yeah.
You know, when you get older, you need your rest. I get that.
Yeah.
You know what's cool is
there
is actually a character in the show. He's kind of an older show business mentor figure, like a writer. He's Jewish. His name is David.
Yeah.
David Leibowitz.
Close.
You know, kind of like won a lot of Cable Ace Awards in his day.
So you need somebody. You need an actor.
No. Lewis Black's going to play that role, but I just wanted to let you know that that's kind of one of the characters that's going to be on the show. So HBO's legal team kind of wanted me to tell you that if you try to sue them, they're going to destroy you. So I hate to be. Don't kill the messenger.
Lewis lives in Manhattan.
Yeah. Well, you know, when they found out I got Lewis Black, they were like, yeah, we'll get car service for him. Like, he doesn't have to wake up a minute earlier than he needs to. we're kind of working around his schedule a little bit.
Yeah, but
because older, you know how you older folks get, you get a little bit tired, and so I wouldn't want to do that to him to make him feel obligated.
Hope he's doing okay. That he needs a gig like that to have to.
Yeah, he's going to be making a lot of money next year because we're co-headlining across Europe.
Wow. Seems like a shame to have to work that hard at his age. You know, it's
two hours a night. Plus, he and I are going to be he's a writer, too.
I like to sleep in my own bed. You know, I have my creature.
So he's actually going to co-author half of the scripts for this show.
A lot of writing to do to pay the bills. I hope his business steal his money.
It's so funny.
It sounds desperate. Lewis Black, it sounds like he's desperate. I don't know.
Well, I guess it's just they're doing something called preemptively nominating us for an Emmy, just based on both of our track records.
Sounds like you're just chasing gold and mammon at the expense of your spiritual growth. It just seems like empty experience.
I wish I could be back in New York City doing QED shows again. Oh, God. I mean, that's because then you're doing it for yourself, you know? I mean, literally, there's three people in the audience.
So, Alex...
You're literally doing it for yourself.
Alex, you spoke to Alex, huh?
Yeah, he's the one who hooked me up with Lewis.
It's interesting because 5 years ago, I introduced Alex was 18 at the time, 5 years ago, and I introduced him to Lewis Black, which is... He never would have met Lewis Black had it not been for me. It's kind of interesting that...
Cats in the cradle, man. Yeah. Cats in the cradle. What can I tell you?
Well...
But you know, the great thing is, because I handed Alex the script, the pilot script. He said Lewis would be great, not only for the role of David, we both agree that was our first choice, but also he said, what you need is someone who's an experienced writer. You know, he studied playwriting at Yale. And he said, you need someone who's, really good at writing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, really, really good at comedy. Because we were talking about you initially.
Really?
But then we both agreed, that would make you feel bad. Like, if your scripts weren't up to par or, if they weren't any good or you didn't know what you were doing or, you freaked out halfway through the process and quit or... You know, if you kind of just had a meltdown and cried a lot at the writer's table or, you just kind of embarrassed yourself or, peed yourself at a party or, didn't know who anyone was and kind of insulted everybody in the room or, just kind of got into a big flame war with someone on Twitter or any of these things that could possibly happen to you. We felt it wouldn't be fair to you to put you in the spotlight like that. Like in the firing line.
Thank you for that. And I'm being very selective.
Also, it's just kind of
Wow.
We agreed, you're so comfortable in that SRO you live in. You have your bathroom down the hall.
Well, I thought it...
You have your kitchenette.
When Alex said he would get me SRO, I thought he meant standing room only, like I was going to sell out a club.
No, he would never let you sell out.
Yeah,
staying true to your principles, man.
Right. The only reason I'm in an SRO is I thought it meant standing room only. And not that I need to stay at this.
Right.
But it.
Right. No, I understand you can't afford furniture for it. So technically an SRO, standing room only.
So.
As what I heard, but I would never.
Hey, so I don't know if Alex told you about my theory about back to zero. Have I ever told you my back to zero theory about comedy?
No.
I feel like guys like me who get really successful. Well, obviously, you know what success is like.
I'm just stepping up the rungs of the ladder. I'm not ready. Look, just because of Variety or, the New York Times would call me a huge success. I don't agree with that.
Yeah.
I mean, success is just that anyone who's above ground breathing during the day.
Right. So you're new to the success game.
Right.
I've been around the block and I've been successful for a long time.
You have been around successful people, right?
I've been successful for a long, and I stay successful doing this back to zero thing, where I do a reset.
Is that like a weight loss?
No, it's I do a reset to keep my comedic chops sharp. One of the things I like to do is swim around in the muck with the new guys. And it's not about the money, believe me. It's not about the money.
Right.
I like to.
I hope not.
Yeah, I'll occasionally staff up and take a job.
Right.
Just to mix it up.
Very occasionally.
I'll mix it up with the young kids because they keep me sharp. They keep me honest. I kind of do it on the DL. You know what DL means?
Yes, it means you're secretly gay.
And maybe I was misled. What I meant is I don't make a big thing out of it. I go in there. I hang out in the writing room. I work really hard.
Right.
I show up on time as though
right.
like I'm just like a kid starting out. I don't make trouble. I keep my
right.
mouth shut. I'm very supportive of everybody
right.
in the room. You know, I don't create camps. You don't have to worry.
You're definitely known for showing up early and leaving late and asking if there are food or drink tickets. Those are the things you are known for.
My back to zero program where I just shed all my accomplishments and I'm just a raw nerve
right.
starting out
right.
again. Get that hunger again. Get that hunger because that's what makes a man funny. My back to zero
right.
program, occasionally I will staff up. I'll go Writers Guild minimum, you know? I'll do the minimum. I'll keep my mouth shut. I'll work really hard. I won't make
right.
trouble. I don't hang out.
A minimum wage job. I got it.
Writers Guild, you know, union job. I don't hang out at craft services,
right.
bad mouthing the star and the executive producer. Really, back to zero is about learning to be a team player, getting out of myself
right.
and being part of the larger fabric. That's what I like to do. The same way George Clooney or Brad Pitt will take a supporting role in an independent film to help a new director.
Right.
Young actor starting out. So are
yeah. yeah, I mean, George has been really supportive of Liam. You're right. He's taking SAG minimum to have a co-starring role in my show. So I totally hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, and that's why I would never insult you by offering you any kind of paying gig whatsoever.
Well, I think Writers Guild minimum.
In any form.
I think,
you know.
One of the things, I think both of us have gotten to a point in our career where obviously
right.
Writers Guild minimum is slavery and it's insulting, but that's not why I'm going to do this for you. I'm doing it really for myself, Liam.
No, I mean, I understand. I mean, I hear what you're saying. I agree. I would never hire you.
Right.
Like, I was thinking about it, like, it's kind
right.
of like one of those, like, hey, you know, whatever happened to, like, I was at NBC and I was talking to some people there and it was just kind of like, oh, what's David Feldman up to? And I told them that I was going to do your podcast and they were like, oh yeah, David Feldman, that's a blast from the past, from the distant past, like, you know, like a dinosaur times kind of deal. You know how industry jokes around like that.
Mm-hmm.
And we agreed, you know, that what you're doing at QED really is important too.
Right.
It's important that there's guys like you with a lot of street cred
and
or sometimes even living on the street cred.
Yeah. And one of the, you know, one of the ways I keep my street cred is by going to work every day.
Right.
This back to zero thing.
Right.
No more than
zero vision. Right.
Zero. And it's just all about serving others.
Right.
I think you would, if I decide to
like
do
a waiter.
This, if I decide.
Like a caterer.
You know, should I deign to go back to zero on Liam! Exclamation point.
Right.
You would learn
what?
Humility from me. Humility is more than just spiritual. It's just good for business. I think my humility will go a long way.
Right. What
you.
Profits a man who gains the world if he loses his soul?
Right.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
My back to zero thing to keep me funny. Being funny is a lot about humility.
A lot of working with Chris Gersbeck and, you know, Freddie Goldstein and kind of learning from them a little bit.
Yeah, well,
learning the basics of joke writing from them, and
I really need humility. Do you
right.
understand what I'm saying? I have gotten to a point where I've been so successful and things have been going so well. I'm kind of begging you. I know this sounds insane.
Right.
I'm kind of begging you to let me be humble before you and God.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? That I would be...
The guild minimum.
I'm a big union guy. You know that, right?
Right. Definitely. All my shows are union.
Yeah. And here's the thing, because I'm big with the union, all for one, one for all, the unity.
Right.
We're all in this together. As a...
Right. We can do it. Like Rosie the Riveter.
Right. So my thing is, and I'm only saying this because I'm going back to zero. This is about my humility and my support
right.
for the Writers Guild. In order for me
right.
to understand how important the union is, I think it might be a good idea for you to pay me a little less than Writers Guild. Maybe off the books. I know you can't do that, and it really makes me sick to even suggest this. However, I think I'd be doing
right.
my fellow union members, the rank and file, I'd be doing them a favor, because then I could speak from experience on what it's like to take a non-union job, because I think I've forgotten it.
Here's my thoughts about that, is I just learned that I'm going to have to fire my writer's assistants and some of their assistants to pay for this cocaine. I'm not sure. I mean, like, if I'm getting rid of assistants' assistants, I didn't even know these writer's assistants had assistants. I'm freeing up this budget for cocaine.
Right.
And, you know, I got to be honest, like, there's just not going to be really, once I'm done slashing the budget, any room for anyone other than me and Lewis, Alex's friend from the deli, Chris Gersbeck, yeah. I got him a job, and Micah Fox, and Karen Fian, and gosh, who else is on? Jim Earl and Barry Lank and,
yeah.
you know, Tony Kameen and, oh yeah, Aaron Sorkin.
Okay.
He's got a big fee.
All right.
And,
so,
you know, and then they all have to have their assistants. And so I'm looking in the budget for the assistants. Maybe if I could trim a few of those guys and maybe get a wholesale deal in my cocaine, I could afford to pay you $150. And is 150, I mean, that's a lot, right?
150 what?
You know, 150. 150
what?
150K. 150,000? No, K is my shorthand for a week.
150 a week?
150 a week, yeah. It's a little below WJ minimum. In fact, it's so far below WJ minimum, technically... You would be billed in the credits, not at all.
That's a lot of humility.
You know, I would offer to pay you more, but you gave me this whole rap about how you want to start over.
I don't need to get that spiritual. How about something a little less enlightened?
Okay, I mean, I could give you $100 a week.
That's too purifying for me. That's way
too
much.
You mean you want like a yoga mat?
No, no, I'm saying is 100, 150 a week is too much.
I got that.
No,
so 50 a week.
No,
50 a week, and you can have whatever's left over from craft services at the end of the shoot.
My ego would just evaporate, and while that's something that we all strive for, I really think I would get the bends from that.
That's great.
You said 150. I think that's probably... in the range of spirituality that I can.
I really like that a lot.
In. Yes. So I start when?
I like that a lot.
When do I?
Oh, no. I thought you were talking about the Bends, the Radiohead album. Well, you could, I guess, at 125 a week.
Oh, that's a little.
I
thought.
We would have to
I'm just
candy budget.
Hang on for 1 second. I really think 150 is like.
115, got it.
No, 150.
So at 115 a week.
No, 150. I'm not doing
right.
I mean, it's insane that we're talking about money because this is all about
right.
my spiritual well-being. But I think
100. And it's so awkward to talk about it with a good friend.
Yeah. So $150.
You know, $115, got it.
$150.
Agreed, $115.
$150 a week.
$115 every other week, got it. Biweekly.
How about $115 a week?
$115 bimonthly, got it. You're just negotiating against yourself now, pal.
Okay,
I'm trying to bring you up to 115 a week.
How about 115 every other week? Look, I'll be honest with you. Normally I wouldn't make this deal, but
right.
I'm really starving for spirituality and enlightenment.
Right. Okay, well, I'll tell you what.
Yeah.
You know, I told my 10-year-old nephew he could have a job. And we were going to use that money to pay him because he kind of had a really good idea for character arc for the last three episodes. Kind of one of the most intelligent things that would ever be aired on HBO. But, you know, okay. I'll just tell him that he's going to have to take an executive producer credit, you know, like it.
What am I getting?
You are getting 100 every other week. And if the WGA asks, I've never heard of you. And also, we might have to stuff you in a car trunk for 8 hours if they come do an on-set visit.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I mean that.
Well, listen, man, I just don't want you to think. I like to think of myself as one of the few guys in Hollywood who remembers his friends.
Thank you.
And is grateful to everyone who gave him a leg up. There's a lot of people in this town that wouldn't give you that kind of deal.
Well, thank you. Everybody, when they see David Feldman, it's like, pull out the red carpet. Let's all be successful and brag to David.
Yes, give him your secondhand carpet so he has something to sleep on.
It feels so good to be given an opportunity to just re-experiencing my birth again in show business. And I thank you for that. I thank you for the opportunity to be humble. Hey, congratulations.
Oh, thank you. For what?
For getting on the David Feldman Show.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.